Well, good morning. My name is Lee. I serve as the college pastor here at Cornerstone Church. And, a little feedback. No worries. All right. I've been on staff here for a little over 3 years. My wife, Lacey, and I both went to Auburn. We've been back here for about 4 years now. And we just had our first child. Our daughter, Finley, is 7 weeks old. And it's been an amazing journey and ride so far. And she's awesome and all of that. And yesterday, I had a friend tell me, man, tonight's going to be terrible. We're losing an hour of sleep. And I just have a seven-week-old. I've been losing sleep for 7 weeks. We tried to store up for it beforehand. That didn't work. So now we find ourselves in this place where daylight savings really didn't matter at all to us. We were losing sleep anyway. But all that said, it's been, like I said, a fantastic journey. And we have just absolutely loved every minute of it. So just a little bit about me and our family, my wife Lacey and our daughter Finley. A couple quick things. We have a team right now, two teams actually, and I think this is the first time we've done this where we've sent two teams simultaneously that are doing work alongside of one another. We have a strictly college age team, so we have 11 college students that are going that trip. But then we also have an ag professionals trip. Yeah, this was all of them together before they left, the two different trips. Like I said, there's an ag professional team. They're working with the government and with some different groups. But then we have our college team who's going to be working with university students. They're going to be working alongside our partner churches in Biloba and Boringa. So over the course of the next week while they are gone, they left on Friday, they're back next Saturday. If you could just remember them and be praying for them, that would be awesome in the work that they're doing there in Uganda. Today we're wrapping up a series that we've titled Extraordinary, and we've been looking a week at a time just at God doing extraordinary things in desperate situations through ordinary people. And it's been an awesome journey looking at different stories that we're familiar with, some stories that we're not so familiar with, God doing just these incredible works throughout history. And we're going to continue in that today, but also wrap up the series. And then at the end of this morning, we'll have a chance to celebrate communion together. We will remember Jesus' last meal with his disciples. So today's going to be an exciting day. I'm pumped for it. I'm glad to be here with you guys. From the beginning of the story of God, all the way back in creation, God has been doing things for thousands of years that have been pointing people, showing people just how glorious and how mighty and how big he is. So in all of history, everything that God does points back to God himself and displays his glory. And in displaying his glory to men, God has been drawing men to himself ever since the very beginning. So in Deuteronomy, Moses records these words. He says, "Has any God ever tried to take for himself one nation out of another nation? By testing, by signs and wonders, by war, by a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, or by great and awesome deeds, like all the things the Lord your God did for you in Egypt before your very eyes. You were shown these things so that you might know that the Lord is God. Besides him, there is no other." God in the Old Testament, through the people of Israel and leading them out of bondage and all of the miraculous things, the stories that we know so well, the parting of the Red Sea, the crossing the Jordan, all of these stories from the Old Testament, and even if you didn't grow up in the church, you at least know about the parting of the Red Sea and just how amazing and magnificent that would have been. All of these stories displaying God's power in a very supernatural, undeniable, and very real and kind of freaky way all at the same time. And the people of Jesus' day, when Jesus shows up and he starts declaring that the kingdom of God is coming, comes on the tail of 400 years of absolute silence and nothing from God, or so they thought. And so they expected the work that Jesus would come to do in bringing the kingdom of God would have been very much the same as where the God of the Old Testament, where Yahweh, as they would have called him, had left off. But we know that that's not exactly what Jesus does when he shows up on the scene. And Isaiah prophesies these words about the coming of Christ and what would come after him. It says this in 48 verse 6. "You have heard these things," meaning you have heard all of these stories. Your parents and your grandparents have told you all of these stories about what God has done. "Look at them all. Will you not admit them? From now on, I will tell you of new things, of hidden things unknown to you." This morning, we are going to zoom in and look at the start of this new era of extraordinary things that God is doing in and through his people in a very new and different way. And he does those things just like he did in the Old Testament. He does all of the things that God does here in the story we're going to look at this morning. He does it in and through the people of God through ordinary men and women. So if you have your Bibles with you, you can go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 14. That's where we're going to spend the rest of this morning. As you're going there, these words will be on the screen too if you don't have your Bible with you. But in Matthew 14, Matthew records that at the beginning of this chapter, he records that one of Jesus' best friends, the guy that actually baptized him and was preparing kind of the soil, so to speak, the ground, the air, so to speak, of Jesus' coming, that he has been killed, murdered by Rome. He's been beheaded. And so Jesus, in very typical fashion, when he is full of just mourning, or he's full of needing the Father, he tries to find a place to get away. And so Jesus climbs in a boat because he can't get away from this crowd of people that have been following him around. Remember that he's been teaching, he's been healing, he's been traveling with his disciples, and the crowd of people that is following him is continuing to grow. And so alone time, not real big on Jesus's number of things going on in that time. But he attempts to sneak away, but the crowds, he attempts to get in this boat, but the crowds come to the shore nearest him, and Jesus sees them, and the scripture says that he has compassion on them. So he gets back out of the boat, he comes ashore, he ministers to them, he heals them, he teaches them, he continues to do what he's been doing. And then we have the miraculous feeding of the thousands, feeding of the 5,000 is what your Bible may say, including just the men, it was 5,000. So thousands and thousands of people with the women and children there, all being fed on this day, all on the tail end of a day where Jesus' best friend has just been killed. So, emotional day, pretty high one for Jesus. So this is kind of where we pick up our story this morning in verse 22 of chapter 14. It says this, "Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd." So dinner's over, they've fed everybody, and he dismisses his disciples and says, "Get in the boat, go across," and then he dismisses the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. When evening came, he was alone there, but the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against them. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. So at the end of this very long and emotional day of starting with news of his friend dying, and now he's fed thousands of people miraculously and healed them and continued to minister to them because he is full of compassion, Jesus goes up on the mountainside and he prays. And what happens is the stage is set once again at the end of this, after being refreshed by his Father and his presence on the mountainside, the stage is set once again for Jesus to show his disciples and the people who are following him his great power. The waves and wind are holding these disciples back. They have been at the oars all night long, and more than likely they were about 2 or 3 miles offshore, which is about halfway across the lake in the midst of this massive storm. They've been rowing from the beginning of the night until the fourth watch of the night, which is somewhere between 3 and 6 a.m. So they've been at this quite a while, incredibly exhausted. Now they are completely isolated in the center of this lake in the middle of the night with howling winds and massive seas all around them. And then Matthew continues on in verse 26. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, Jesus is walking out to them. When the disciples saw him, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." Once refreshed by his Father, Jesus goes out on the lake. He's walking towards them. He shows up close enough to the boat for them to see him. And they cry out, "It's a ghost," meaning very specifically they cry out thinking that this is a demon that has come to deceive them, not just the friendly Casper kind of ghost, but a not-so-great kind of ghost. And on the top of all that, they're completely alone in the middle of this lake. And Jesus tells them, "Take heart, it is I. Don't be afraid." This "it is I" is the same language that Yahweh spoke to Moses in Exodus. When Moses asked Yahweh, "Who are you? What will I call you when people ask me your name?" And Yahweh responds, "I am." Jesus is using the same language, "I am." And basically what he's saying is, "Take heart, be of courage, I am is with you." And just as Yahweh has always been revealing his glory to his people, Jesus continues to do so here on the Sea of Galilee. If the winds and waves were bad enough to prevent the disciples from making it across the lake in, what is that, 9 hours' time, then it would have been a pretty fierce storm. The seas would have been treacherous. And in verse 28, we read this, "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Peter's the first to overcome his fear, but he's still a little bit hesitant. And he says, Lord, if it's you, I need a little more proof other than the fact that you're walking on water and talking to me in the middle of this storm. If it's you, command me to come to you. In the midst of Peter's fear around him with all of these people who are incredibly afraid, in the midst of it, Peter's faith in who Jesus is continuing to grow. Fear is an absolutely valid emotion. It's something that comes naturally. It's something that God has given us to protect us from certain situations. But it's also something that can take center stage in our life. And for the disciples here in this place, especially with several of them being fishermen and knowing exactly just how bad the Sea of Galilee can get, because the way the mountains are formed in that part of the world, they form basically a funnel into the Sea of Galilee. And so if the winds are just right, it can blow incredibly hard. So on this relatively small lake, you can have 6 to 8 foot swells in any given moment. So these guys, especially the fishermen, Peter being one of them, would have known exactly how dangerous this situation is that they're in. So again, fear, perfectly acceptable. But Jesus walking on the water, testing the faith of his disciples, meaning he's testing whether or not they will believe that he is who he says he is. Testing their faith, simultaneously Jesus is growing their faith. This is an important truth for us to remember this morning. So Jesus responds very simply to Peter, come on, come. So Peter swings one leg over the side of the boat, then the other over the side of the boat, and he puts his feet on, not in the water, and he begins walking toward the Savior. And all of Jesus's ministry, all of Jesus's ministry with his disciples, his teaching, his healing, his casting out demons, all the things that Jesus was doing on this earth, all of it was followed by and wrapped up in the initial invitation, come, follow me. Come and follow me. Come and see what I'm doing. Come and do as I am doing. Isaiah's prophecy is in full swing here, and Jesus is beginning to show his disciples that not only am I showing my glory to you through myself, but I am doing a new thing, the thing that you expect for me to do here in this place as we're working and living and ministering together is not what you expected. It's new. Peter, outside of the boat, in large seas at this point, walking towards Jesus on the water, is beginning to experience what exactly God has been talking about in this prophecy of, I am doing a new thing. Jesus' ministry up until this point was incredibly miraculous, to say the least. He turns water into wine. He calls his disciples to him. So he's got this group of guys that are following him around. Disciple simply means learner. He has this group of people who are learning to do what he's doing, to teach as he's teaching. He begins traveling, healing, and leading people to repentance and casting out demons and feeding the hungry and doing all these incredible things. And he uses parables as he's teaching people, those that would have ears to hear, to come to him in a new way. And here in Matthew 14, this invitation of come and follow me has been riding over all that Jesus has been doing. And at this point in Matthew 14, on the water, Jesus walking, the boat in the middle of this storm, Jesus is essentially saying, it's time to stop watching. You have been watching all that I have been doing. I'm walking on water. This is a big deal. And Jesus calls to Peter, come. The original invitation clearly in the forefront of Peter's mind here. I'm not supposed to just follow this guy around and watch what he's doing. I'm supposed to do what he's doing. So Peter swings one leg over the boat. He gets out of the water and he's following Jesus. And without realizing it, Peter is experiencing this new thing that Isaiah has been talking about. And while Peter's faith is growing, it's obviously not perfect. We get to verse 30. And we read this, but when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, Lord, save me. He saw the waves and the wind, and he begins to sink. And so we have a quick video that's from the Bible series on the History Channel. This hasn't showed yet on Sunday nights, but it's just a very good visual for what we're talking about here. So let's go ahead and watch this video.
This is so dangerous! We should turn back while we still can!
You heard what he said! He wanted the cross!
What is that?
No, Tom, Peter, you of little faith, why did you doubt? You need to be strong.
It's not as if Peter and the disciples hadn't seen the weather already. They had been fighting it all night, but for that moment, in the midst of their fear, in the midst of Jesus calling to Peter, the grace of God holds Peter's gaze. Faith is growing. Peter has his eyes perfectly set on Jesus, and fear is completely gone. You can see it in his eyes in the video when he's getting ready to get out of the boat. Faith overriding fear in an incredible way, and then distracted by everything around him, he's underwater. Even though he was distracted by fear of drowning, his faith again wins the day. We read in verse 31, immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him and said, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" Peter has called out, "Lord, save me," in the verse previous, and Jesus reaches out his hand and says, "You of little faith." Faith continues to win in Peter's story here. It's not perfect. He sinks. Jesus reaches out and grabs him and saves him with the wind and waves all around him and says, "You of little faith." Obviously not no faith. So if Jesus is growing Peter's faith, why does he ask the question, "Why did you doubt?" And I started looking through this and I started thinking through, okay, God, what are you saying to your people? What are you saying to Peter in that moment? And essentially what I believe Jesus is saying to him is, Peter, don't you remember? Don't you remember all that you've seen? Don't you remember all that I've taught you? Don't you remember all the people who have been healed? Don't you remember all the amazing things that you've seen me do? Don't you remember all that I'm doing in you? Don't you remember all those who were hungry yesterday? Don't you remember that I commanded you to feed them? And don't you remember that it was my power in and through you by which we fed them to the extent that there were tons of food left over? So if that's the case, if you remember all of those things, Peter, why do you doubt that I'm capable of doing this in you today? He is saying my power is sufficient to save and heal and lead many to repentance and bring them home into my glory. But not only that, my power is enough to do these things through you. Follow me, do as I am doing. Why did you doubt? In verses 32 and 33, wrapping up this section, it says, when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly you are the Son of God. Surely Peter at this point is already worshiping the Son of God. This new thing that Isaiah prophesied would happen, would come, is happening among the disciples in this moment. And it is the power of God, the glory of God, in and through the people of God. It is the power of God in and through the people of God. Jesus came to bring many sons to glory. We sing that song. It's the writer of Hebrews saying very clearly that Jesus came to redeem men, to reconcile men to the glory of God. And in bringing men and women to salvation, God then calls those men and women into action to display his power and his glory. And we no longer part seas. We no longer, as far as I know, walk on water. But the people of God today, for us, where we find ourselves, in our jobs, in our families, with our children, whatever situation we find ourselves in, we are bearing the power and glory of God to the world. This is no small thing. And for whatever reason, unbeknownst to mankind, God has chosen to reveal himself. Since Christ came and lived and died and was raised again, God has chosen to reveal himself in and through us, his people. Peter's road to faith was a winding one, and ours is really no different. Peter's was full of intense fervor and devoted commitment to Jesus and eventual steadfastness, but it was also filled with much doubting and questioning and even abandonment of Jesus when he was being ready to be crucified. And ours is truly no different. We wander. We are a people who come and go. We are a people who are not steadfast unless we are made steadfast. But Jesus still invites and he says, come, follow me. Meaning very simply, if you are doing anything in this world that is outside of me, it's not worth it. I have so much more to offer you. Come follow me. And in displaying his power in saving those who are lost, Jesus also challenges us to come. Get out of the boat. Won't you believe that I'm capable of doing this thing through you? Faith will always override fear, and it always leads us to believe that God is who he says he is, that God will do the thing that he says he will do. And it is believing in faith in who he is that there is nothing that is too great for our God. There is no situation you find yourself in. There is no moment in any type of argument with your spouse that God is not perfectly capable of speaking through you into that situation. Whatever comes in your life, sickness, heartache, whatever it is, God is perfectly capable of being glorified in and through you. His grace, His mercy are sufficient in and through you. So this year, as we dream together as a people, as a church, Cornerstone Church here in Auburn and Opelika, we are going to spend time looking at this project called Dream 2020, where we're going to be looking to the future. We're going to be asking the question, God, what could be? What are the things that you want this people to do? We're going to spend the better part of this year gathering those dreams. And then, as Rusty's said several times this spring already, at Celebration Dinner next year in January, we're going to unroll a plan for what we feel like God is leading us to do. And God is essentially asking a people here in Cornerstone Church, as a God who does incredible things in and through his people, will you believe in faith that there is nothing too great for me? Will you believe that the dream I am giving you for a reconciled relationship is of my power? Will you believe that whatever the dream is that you come up with, whatever the thing is that God puts on your heart, the question is not, can God do this? We believe that God can do in and everything he wants to. The question for us is, will you have faith to believe that there's nothing beyond his power? Will the waves crash around us? Will the seas hold us back at times? Most certainly. We cannot be guaranteed a perfect, blissful road into this future that we are dreaming of, but we believe wholeheartedly in the promises of a great God who says, I will be with you, I am for you, there is nothing that I cannot accomplish. And if our eyes will remain fixed on him and not focus on the thing around us, so we will not focus on the things that distract us, if we will hold our gaze in faith in him, fear will always lose to faith. While it's a perfectly valid emotion, it's not one we are called to follow. We are a people who live by faith. We are a people who live by things we can't see. We follow a God who, for most of us, is not physically tangible. Now, if you can see God, that's a whole other conversation. But for most of us, we follow by faith things that we cannot see. And if our eyes remain fixed on him over the course of the next 6 months, over the course of the next 6 years, over the course of the next, God willing, 60 years, we will serve a God who will always come through. And again, if we fix our eyes on him, we will hear our Savior say, don't you remember the day we met? Don't you remember what it felt like to know that you were loved by me? Don't you remember that you were dead and now you are alive? Don't you remember that in the midst of this chaos, you found hope in me? Don't you remember all the stories that I have done of old, which is why we have them in Scripture, by the way? Don't you remember everything that I've done for my people? Don't you remember those who have gone before you? And then transitioning for us as a people who are looking forward now, won't you believe that there is nothing I can't accomplish through my people? Won't you believe that I am doing a very new thing in and through you? Won't you believe that as you dream of what could be, that I am is with you? That you will be tempted to lose your focus. You will be tempted to look at the wind and the waves. But faith says, remember, I am. Remember, I am with you. We believe, Lord. That's our cry. Be of courage. Don't be afraid. Know that God is with you. And so with that, we are boldly proclaiming as a people, God, won't you give us your dreams of what could be and none of our own.